it said that when you play the game of thrones, you win or you die. Now that doesn't come from the Bible, but the Bible does have a thing or two to say about kings and thrones and power. 1 Samuel chapter 8, this is when the people of Israel begged Samuel, give us a king so that we can be like the other nations. And Samuel tries to talk him out of it. Samuel tries to pray him out of it. God says to Samuel, Samuel, they have not rejected you, they've rejected me. And then Samuel has some words of warning about just what kings and queens are like. Samuel says, these will be the ways of the king who will reign over you. He will take your sons and appoint them to his chariots and to be his horsemen and to run before his chariots. And he will appoint for himself commanders of thousands and commanders of 50. He will take your daughters to be perfumers and cooks and bakers. He will take the best of your fields and vineyards. It goes on and on. The moral of the story is, the king owns you. The king will take what's yours and make it his. And your job is to shut up about it. We don't do kings, queens, and thrones in this country. We don't play the Game of Thrones around here. That's kind of what we are all about, is having thrown off the yoke of royalty. See, the king, a true king, maybe not some of the figureheads reigning in some places today, but a true king is the sovereign, and the king holds all the power. There's a lot of freedom in a king's realm, if you're the king. The king hoards all the freedom to himself. And history is painted red with the blood of those who have been destroyed because they got in the way of kings and queens consolidating their power. And sure, there have been good kings, even wise kings, even great kings. Even saints have been kings. But even then, things aren't very secure. You may have the best king in the world today. What happens tomorrow? What happens when he's gone and somebody else takes his throne and all the power to himself? We call Jesus priest, prophet, and king. Priest? I'm good with that. Prophet? No problem. The king? King is a brutal imagery. The kingship of Christ is what we'll call this morning the ultimate Reformation. For 3 weeks, we've been talking about how we are the living, breathing presence of Jesus Christ in this world. We've talked about how Christ acts as prophet in this world through us when we advocate for peace and justice in our society. We've talked about how Christ acts as priest in this world through us when we offer ourselves in self-giving love for the reconciliation of others. Christ also reigns as king in the world today, through us, in us, and as us. Now kingship is about power. Kings like to hoard all the power and freedom to themselves and even claim a fraudulent divine mandate to do so. But our king, the Jesus of the Gospels, looks at this game of thrones that kings and queens have been playing through the ages, and he makes a mockery of it. For the Jesus of the Gospels makes a mockery of the pretense, of the might, of the riches of emperors and kings, when he, the lowly son of a carpenter, rides to claim his throne on the back of a humble donkey. Jesus turns kingship upside down. He changes the rules of this game of thrones by knocking down the gates of the castle and saying to us, come, come on in, sit with me, share my throne, reign with me as kings and queens, all of us. Jesus is king, but he has not made us into subjects. I no longer call you servants, he says at his Last Supper. I no longer call you servants, but I call you friends. The Jesus of Scripture shares his kingship with us so fully that we are all kings and queens at his side. The freedom that only kings enjoy belongs to everyone equally in the gospel covenant. And that's the covenant we entered into at our baptism. So how can we keep from sinning? I can't see it now, but somewhere over there it says, I sin because I'm free. Or I think that because I'm crazy. Does it say that over there? I sin because I'm free. That's why we sing. That's why we can't keep from singing. Because Jesus Christ has given us freedom. The Apostle Paul said that it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Or that it is for liberation that Christ has liberated us. And the letter of James says that our gospel covenant is the law of perfect liberty. Brothers and sisters, we sing because we are free. 500 years ago, October 31st, 1517, Martin Luther advocated for freedom from elements of the institutional church of his time, which had grown corrupt. The Reformation that followed revolutionized the church and therefore revolutionized the world. At our best, Protestant Christians have advocated for the freedom of individuals to weigh evidence for themselves, to form their own ideas, and to live out those ideas according to the dictates of their consciences. Certainly our own Stone Campbell movement is rooted in just that. That we would not let any man or woman be constrained by dogma or by ecclesiastical authority from joining together as equals around this table. That's what our movement has always been about. That's the wholeness that our movement seeks to bring to this fractured world. We sometimes get an image in our head, I think. And this doesn't matter what side of the Great Reformation divide we're on. We get this image in our minds that the very first church, the very first Christians, the ancient church, was uniform. That there was one way of being a Christian in the beginning, and then people split off, and things got off the rails, and people dreamt up new ideas, and corruption set in away from one pure original. And whoever is saying that will almost certainly think then that he or she has found that one pure original. The more we look at the evidence of Scripture and the way our faith has evolved, the less that picture looks accurate. The ancient church, the church of Scripture, was incredibly diverse. There's no one way of being Christian that lies at the core, but it's diversity all the way down. The community behind the Gospel of Matthew, for example, is very different than the community of the Apostle Paul, which is very different than the community of the Gospel of John. The Protestant Reformation, at its best, has restored that diversity, giving us a Christian faith heritage with room enough for Russian Orthodoxy, and Presbyterianism, for Pentecostals and Latter-day Saints, for megachurches and house churches, for the papacy and the Salvation Army, for the Order of St. Benedict and the Unitarian Universalist Association, for stake handlers and Episcopalians, though I've yet to meet a stake handling Episcopalian. The real Reformation is not just 500 years old, but 2,000 years old. The ultimate Reformation dates to the very beginnings of the church, and it is always ongoing. It is also always in danger. The reformer's temptation is to say, I want to be free, and I want you to be free to be just like me. The reformer's temptation is to go back to playing that Game of Thrones that has plagued us since the dawn of civilization. For all the great impact his work would have, Martin Luther would also see the synagogues burn. And no, there wasn't any place that a Jewish person could go in the medieval Christian world and be treated well. But Martin Luther was cruel even for his time and planted a virus of anti-Semitism on steroids in his own homeland that would reverberate down the centuries, culminating in the horrors of the 1930s and 40s. John Calvin would burn dissenters at the stake, just like the old Inquisition. And if I'm being burned at the stake, which has never happened yet, but if I'm being burned at the stake, I don't think it makes me feel any better than the guy lighting me on fire is reformed. Europe would explode in years of warfare. Christians killing Christians in the name of Jesus Christ, the Prince of Peace. And those Reformation wars, my friends, are not just antiques of the 16th century. Those same Reformation wars would continue to rage on in Ireland well into our own lifetime. If you were born after the wars of the Reformation finally cooled down, you were not very old at all. And it's easy to be quite famous, though. See, our movement was pretty small, and we've never had the access to the kind of political power over life and death that some of our forebears have. Alexander Campbell never burned any synagogues. Martin Warren Stone never burned anybody at the stake. And I imagine, no matter how upset the elders of this congregation may be with me for how I preach on any given Sunday, I'm going to make it out of that meeting alive. But, there's a but here. Even we don't get off that easy. We don't like to talk about it, but we owe it to ourselves, to our children, and to generations yet born to never forget the sad, sick fact that the official name of Jonestown was the People's Temple of the Christian Church, Disciples of Christ. Brother Jones was playing the Game of Thrones and would not permit any competition with his rule. Jesus will reign in this world when he reigns in us as kings and queens, when we make his ultimate reformation a reality in our lives. Jesus will reign when we claim our freedom freedom from oppression, freedom of conscience, and freedom for excellence. Real freedom is not about just thinking and doing whatever we want. It is about not being constrained from the outside, but it's not about just doing whatever we want. That is a slavery of its own. That's slavery to our own whims and passions. Real freedom, Christ's freedom, is freeing ourselves to live and flourish and thrive in lives of meaning, lives that are well lived in the service of others. So Jesus will reign in this world when we claim our freedom and when we extend that freedom to those around us, even those we don't like, even those we disagree with vehemently. And that's okay. Christianity is a diverse phenomenon, and there are many types of Christianity that have things about them that bug me, and that's okay. I'm sure there are a lot of things about me that bug a lot of types of Christians. But we must recognize the freedom in one another to make those choices for ourselves. Not by ourselves. Not in isolation. We discern the truth together as a community. But every man and woman in Christ has the freedom to do that hard work of discernment without being barred from full, conscious, and active participation in the life of the community, which is illustrated most beautifully in what we do in just a few minutes around this table. Christ is priest in us, but his altar is the cross. Christ is prophet in us, but his pulpit is the cross. Christ is king in us, but his throne is the cross. We rule as kings and queens by loving. We reign as kings and queens by serving. We show our power by extending the freedom we enjoy to those around us. And that, sisters and brothers, is the ultimate reformation. Good place to start on the path toward ultimate reformation is to make that first choice, to name the name of Jesus Christ as Savior, and to be buried with him in baptism for the remission of sins. If there's anyone here today who's never yet taken those steps, you provide an opportunity to make known your desire to do so. If there's anyone here who would like to become a part of this congregational family, we extend the opportunity this morning to do so. If there is anyone that this community and its leaders can be of service to you in your walk with Jesus Christ, please make that known by coming forward as together we stand and we sing.